scope of this conversation and the challenge, the very challenge with forums like this is we're trying to engage these very complex ideas in a short period of time, and it doesn't allow for the full expression. That, I could design a whole course. As a professor, I could design a whole course around that idea. But in a very streamlined version, the Hajj and the Eid al-Adha. Adha means brighter. And Adha has a focus on the human family and the descendants of Abraham, where anyone who, because Islam, in its ideas, reach back to the Abrahamic tradition. And in the doctrines of Islam, the assertion is that Abraham was a monotheist, and that Islam comes from this tradition of thought of Abraham himself. And this major holiday, the Eid al-Adha, Eid means celebration, Adha means brighter, is a celebration of the gathering of the whole human family back in Mecca, where everyone is equal. When you go to Hajj, everyone wears the same dress. So regardless of your race, your ethnicity, your national origin, or even your status in society, I may have a Nino Cerruti suit on now. And I don't know any more expensive ones than that, but if I may have one on now, or I may drive a Maybach in America, but when I go to Mecca, I have to get rid of all of that. And everyone wears a single style dress, okay? White garment, okay? To symbolize the equality of the human family before God. You know, all this division stuff, men and women, that don't happen in Mecca on Hajj time. And even what we see in mosque, and I challenge people with this all the time. I say, why do you feel that there needs to be this separation? When you go to Hajj in the most holy site for Islam on the planet, in Mecca, and when people are on Hajj, the women and men are walking next to each other. The women are praying in front of the men and all those things at the most holy site. So Hajj is a reminder of a whole lot of things. The human family, the equality of man before God, and the need for all the geniuses from all around the world to come together to help solve the problems that the world is facing, bringing their unique set of circumstances and knowledge together for consultation. There's a very famous day during this period called Arafat, where everyone is on an elevated place, and they're having lectures and classes and discussions all day. Would that make a difference to the American public? Not as much of a difference as Muhammad Ali made. Right? Muhammad Ali, who was once a very controversial figure, when Muhammad Ali passed away a few weeks ago, nobody said, well, he's Muslim, I'm not going to his funeral. You had heads of state flying to America. You had ex-American, former American presidents offering words for Muhammad Ali because as a figure, he transcended religious labels. So a media campaign can only go so far. It's when we embrace, in my opinion, the human service aspects of Islam and serve our fellow human being in accordance with the tradition of Muhammad, that the most useful of you is he who is most useful to humanity. And we begin to change lives. I think that's what is what will shape public perception. To give you an example, I was at Fiesta one day, and I was just getting some fruits and vegetables. I don't always go to Whole Foods. And it's expensive. And I was in line, and I was just minding my own business. You know, I was in my own world. And this kid said, Mom, that's him! And I was like, what did I do? So when that child grows up, his memory of Muslims is not gonna be something that's on television, some wiry person shouting down with America. His image of Muslim is gonna be those people that came to my neighborhood when nobody else did. When others didn't see hope in us, when others wrote us off as dialects and convicts and crime ridden, they still came into our neighborhoods. When other people were afraid to, they came into our neighborhoods and they helped us learn some of the most fundamental things that we needed to learn so that we could pursue the best of our potential and possibilities as human beings. And the third one, I'm not gonna try to answer the third one.
So in the years after 9/11, the NYPD had a pretty, robust is not the best word, program of surveillance of Muslim communities, of mosques and the like. And I was reading in a story, I think the ACLU published it, that a lot of imams were kind of afraid to be so, I guess, not necessarily vocal, but very flamboyant in their speeches, because they were afraid that somebody in the audience might be taking their statements out of context, or that somebody might be filming them. And I just wanted to pose a question to you, Imam Wazir. Have you experienced that yourself, any kind of self-censorship, or anybody that you know? And also, to Hasna, do you think that some of your Muslim friends have kind of self-edited their words as they're afraid of some kind of government surveillance?
Thank you. In 1975, when Imam Warithud-Deen Mohammed became the directional leadership for the, so I have to give some titles and terms to frame a conversation. So the indigenous Muslim community, which he wasn't a leader for everybody, just a group. He invited the FBI in to all the mosques that was under his leadership. He said, because we have nothing to hide. I think we have to be careful in saying that. And when I say careful, I've developed a southern drawl. I don't know how that happened, because I'm from West Texas. And I'm trying to correct it, but I still say careful. I can't say that one either. I'm like, I'm from West Texas. How did I get this southern drawl? But I guess a bit. But I guess you live in an environment long enough, you pick up some of the characteristics. But he did that to disarm and remove any suspicion. But I think as Americans, we have to be very careful how much of our liberty we're willing to give up. Because as American citizens, our privacy should always be protected. And if we start to give our government too many rights when it comes to surveillancing us and watching us and monitoring us and other things like that, I think it will begin to erode some of the very values that our Constitution has promised us. See, and I feel sorry for a lot of Muslim citizens who feel afraid of the government. Never in America should the public feel afraid of the government. Our government should be afraid of its public, because we will vote you out. If you don't perform, we will vote you out. If you don't do good on the job, we will vote you out. And as soon as we as Americans, and so if you remember when I read you the Coalition for Good Government, the fifth right is to petition the government for redress of grievances. And that is one of the great principles that America has, is that even if the government oversteps its bounds and transgresses the rights of citizens, the citizens have the right to sue the government, to petition the government for regress its bounds. If we don't hold to those sacred, special rights that we have in America, pretty soon we're going to find ourselves in a country where we're not as free as our founding fathers intended us to be.
I think Iman answered pretty thoroughly, but I definitely did see kind of a polarization of the Muslim community. You know, people after 9/11 became either Mo or Muhammad. You had to kind of take a stand and say, you know, if you're going to take on that responsibility of representing Islam, because that is kind of the weight that's put on our shoulders now. We don't really have a choice. You know, we know that anyone who interacts with us, we might be the only Muslim they ever meet. So I think it is unfortunate, but it is a reality that we deal with.
Yeah, and even I picked up on this issue in my own research. You know, here is a non-Muslim going into a mosque, trying to carry out research, trying to talk to people and see where people are at. And as a PhD student, I need a transcript, right? I need to record the interview, transcribe it, and then have the data. And there were many times where I was like, do you mind if I record this? And they were just like, whoa, stop, right? What's going on? And there's that climate that it's really bad. I mean, it upsets me genuinely, because I am in the mosque for a reason, not just to simply collect data, but to embrace people. And here I am being, part of this climate, this Islamophobic climate. And it happened in Ireland when I was doing my fieldwork in Ireland. There was a WikiLeaks cable. Remember Julian Assange released all this data, and there was one masjid in Dublin called the Black Pits that was mentioned in this cable as some type of fundamentalist. So I went in there, and they were very, very suspicious of me. It took me a month to build rapport, to at least actually sit down and have a conversation with these people. And that, not only as a researcher, that upset me, but as a human being, that upsets me.
So I wanted to ask the Imam about the legacy of Hadith and the interpretation of Hadith in the interpretations of Islam that has come out in parts of the world where we do find a radicalization, and the legacy of that. And so if there should be a larger or a louder conversation within the Muslim community about a nice reminder that the Quran is the ultimate scripture and Hadith is secondary, and when there are things that seem to be, I guess, in violation, that Quran would always, you know, trounce Hadith. Yeah.
So your question is coming from the perspective of someone who understands that. The average American person doesn't even know what Hadith, what is that? What is a Hadith? So there's a professor, Jonathan Brown. He's a convert. And he asked a question. How did Bukhari and Muslim, which are two, in modern, in historical interpretations of Islam, probably from the medieval period forward, are considered canon. But they were not developed and written until hundreds of years after Muhammad left. So his question was, how did these books become canon? He wrote a 368-page dissertation on that, right? Which obviously we can't do justice to. But in his book, he argued that it wasn't a given that these two books would become canon. He said, and in fear of trivializing his work, I give that as a to preface my remarks. He said it was a way that scholars in a certain period of Islamic growth and thought could legitimize their religious arguments, because there were six or more collections of the saying of Muhammad, and people would bring all these sayings trying to present their arguments as orthodox. So they adapted these two traditions as orthodox while they recognized there were problems within those traditions, but without adopting them, there was no way for them to streamline orthodoxy. So over the years, they just forgot about it, how these books became orthodoxy. So I'm gonna give you a story to kind of sell my point. There was a lady who was cooking a ham, and Muslims don't jam me up, right? Because we don't eat pork, right? And her mother cut the edges of the ham off. And she said, "Mom, why did you do that?" She said, "I don't know. My mother did it." Then she went back to her grandmother and said, "Grandma, why did you do this?" She said, "I don't know. My mother did it." Then she went back to her great-grandma and said, "Now it's a mystery, right? It's mystical. Wow, you cut the edges of the ham off and nobody can tell me why." When she went back to her great-grandmother and said, "Grandma, why do you cut the edges of the ham off?" She said, "Honey, we were poor and the pot was too small, so I just cut the edges off to fit in the pot." There are many things in the saying of Muhammad that were situational, that are no longer even remotely applicable in direct interpretation today. And so yes, there needs to be a reanalysis, but it has to be a guided reanalysis and a responsible reanalysis, so that just anybody doesn't get up and say, "Hey, I'm gonna throw this out, I'm gonna throw that out, I'm gonna throw this out, I'm gonna throw that out." No, but with some rigor, with some rigor, with some criteria. Because if not, we run the risk of completely throwing away the tradition, even the good things in the tradition.
And I just like to give a little context for people who aren't familiar. So the hadith are the sayings, stories, narrations of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And at the time that the scholars of the day started to write these hadiths down, which was a few hundred years after the Prophet's death, there were 6 million hadiths. So one of the scholars that he was talking about earlier, Imam Bukhari, he was able to extract, through a rigorous process, but one that obviously wasn't perfect, from that 6 million, he counted only 6,000 as real hadiths or authentic hadiths. And even within that, obviously, not all have been confirmed. There's a lot, even the scholars of his time, I think, said there were about 200 that needed to be re-examined. And so this is an issue that comes up, you know, whenever we talk about women's rights in Islam as well, because a lot of times, you know, a misogynistic practice in a particular culture actually traces back to a false fabricated hadith, and has no place in Islam, and no backing in the Quran. And I agree that we can't just throw out hadiths altogether, which has been the response of a lot of, I would say, female Muslim academics, because hadiths are important. You know, we need to know how to pray, we need to know basic things, but there definitely needs to be not only a reanalysis, but we need to raise the Quran back up on its pedestal. And that is why this Quran literacy program is so important to me and is so important at the Women's Mosque. I have a friend who was on our board the first couple years, and she read the Quran in English for the first time the first Ramadan that we were open. And after she read it, she turned to me and she's like, "You know what? Before I read the Quran, 80% of my Islam was based on hadith. And now that I've read the Quran, I realize, oh, it's not about, Islam is not just about, you know, how you dress or what you eat. It's actually about giving to the orphans, taking care of the needy, being the caretakers on earth, the people who serve humankind." So I think the answer and the solution to that is to, again, raise Quran literacy.
last two are standing, please save your questions. We're going to move outside to the foyer and have dessert, brownies, and we can continue the conversation there. So please go, and then we'll move outside.
My name is I'm a grad student at the Department of Religion. I study radical Islam and jihadist groups. So basically, I think my question has actually been shaped by a book I read. The book was written by Christopher Bale. So in Christopher Bale's book, the title of the book is Terrified, How Anti-Muslim Fringe Organizations Became Mainstream. I think it's actually very important for us to make a clarification about what exactly the public are scared about in Islam. I think it's very important. Several political leaders in this country that have actually spoken about Islam in the public discourse, they've specified that what they're actually against is radical Islam. Radical Islam that opposes pluralism. I don't think that anyone will actually be against some of the discourse that have been discussed here today, actually. But radical Islam is the main question. So my first question is, how should Muslims actually respond to the narrative of radical Islam, which is so pervasive and which has this predominance in the public space? That's the first question. Now, the second question is directed mainly to the Imam. When Ben Carson actually said that the American Constitution and Sharia is not compatible, as a student of theology and politics, I've been studying Sharia for several years. To some extent, I think I actually believe in what Ben Carson said, and these are the reasons. And I want the Imam to actually respond to that. Now, how do you deal with the question of apostasy? For example, it is clearly written in Islamic theology. It's clearly written in Islamic theology that whoever leaves Islam should be killed. Now, the question is, if you're living in a secular society based on Western liberal ethos, how do Muslims deal with questions like that? Thank you so much.
First, I would like to say, this idea that the American public needs to be really petrified of radical Islam, I don't think that's really the issue. I think the issue is radicalization across the board, and I think a lot of people in the audience right now are probably a bit frustrated that the government and the American public focuses so much on radical Islam when there's also a lot of other forms of radical whatever in this society, white supremacism, a lot of things, and why aren't we talking about those groups? Why? So I just wanted to clarify that. I know your question was also talking about a Muslim response. As a non-Muslim, I'm not going to respond to it.
I just want to say, ISIS and Al-Qaeda are to Muslims and Islam as the KKK are to white people. So I want to make that clear that, you're asking Muslims to respond for crazy people. I would never go up to a white person and say, explain to me what's going on with the KKK. So just to put it in context, I lost my train of thought. It'll come back to me in a second. But
well, thank you for that, because the KKK burned a cross in the yard of the mosque that I am the imam of in 1983. I wasn't here at the time. I was in El Paso, Texas. But that's one of the most notorious questions. But I think the question that you ask about Islamic law is a question that takes some time to answer. But one of the main points that was brought up this evening is the value of going back to the Quran. There's nothing in the Quran that suggests killing an apostate. Nothing. As a matter of fact, the Quran says, "La ikraha fit din." So now I have to get technical on you, right? Let there be no compulsion in religion. Truth stands out firm against falsehood. And Imam W.D. Muhammad, who I told you is the preeminent scholar for Islam in America and history of America, he said, if you try to force someone to be a Muslim, you are actually insulting God. And you're insulting Islam to think that you have to force someone to practice it. And I will say the same about the idea of killing someone. But now I have to give you some context. In my understanding,
those verses were not talking about a legal necessity. It was a question about those who were Muslim once, who became non-Muslim and were attacking you in war because the idea of the sacredness of the blood of your brother in faith. So if they're coming back at me in war, how do I even address this? And this is what my teacher taught us when he was interpreting this, that those allowances were more not, so when you, even when you use the term apostate, you have to put in the context of 6th century Arabia, all these terms, daughter of Islam, daughter of Harb, which is way outside the implication of this discussion is way outside what is even possible in these brief moments, but since you interjected it, I have to address it to a certain degree. Even that dichotomy of seeing the world as the home of peace and the home of war was the reality in the 7th century. But in modern times, when you have a nation state that protects the rights of its citizens to practice their religion unmolested, even this dichotomization of the world no longer exists. And actually, some modern Muslim thinkers argue that even this historical romantic idea of an Islamic state, in the context of modern times when your rights to practice your religion is protected by your constitution, that the constitution actually serves the role that the original Islamic state served, and in that context, there's no need for this romanticized idea about an Islamic state. And that's around three dissertations worth of research.
Well,